5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Better than most.
And works out of the shotgun. He takes it. Facing pressure. He's in trouble. He's spun around. He's able to get away. Looks to throw. He does. Downfield. And a leaping catch is made. Down at the 25. What a play. Even Tyree comes up with the ball. What a play by Eli Manning.
Here is Brady Quinn looking, pump fakes, he rolls to the near side, throws it, it's caught by Samosa, inside the 20, inside the 10, he's going in, Notre Dame has scored with 27 seconds left, Brady Quinn does it again.
You're listening to another edition of Sports Today with Peter J. Here's your host, Peter J. Mulroy.
Well, it's been an interesting 24 hours with the start of the 2024 NFL draft out in Detroit. Man, is that city packed. 700,000 strong, you know, across the board. They said reports coming in with the city, you know, taking in the draft either at the bars and the restaurants out there and the little square that they had set up. I mean, that's a lot of people. I mean, this is a Detroit city area that has been thirsting for good quality football, and they finally have it with Dan Campbell, Jared Goff, and company, and they get to host the NFL draft this year. So plenty to talk about there. MLB season, basically a month in. So there's been loads going on there. Who's hot, who's not. I'll get into that. And obviously we have the NBA and NHL playoffs going on. So welcome back to the latest edition of Sports Today with Peter J. This Friday, April 26th edition. Those listening live, just a touch after 7 p.m. on the East Coast. And, you know, I guess this is taking the good with the bad, right? I appreciate the fact that people have been reaching out on social media. Of course, the lead component there being Instagram at Sports Today with Peter J, J-A-Y. You can send me messages and stay up to the minute with the show as well. Messaging me as to when the show was going to return. Now, I took a couple weeks off, school related, obviously daddy duties here. And then obviously I've been doing the stuff with the Irish Tribune, the Notre Dame centric credentialed member of the Notre Dame media. We've been hosting our show First in Gold as well each and every week. My partner, Nick Kramer, does a great job with that, getting it out across all the platforms as well. More on that later in the program. But you got to find time around all of these things. So I appreciate the fact that people have been reaching out. Hey, when's the show coming back? Well, here we are. Right. It sucks that I had to answer questions like that because I could have done a better job promoting it myself across social media, let you know what the schedule was. I will do that moving forward. So thank you to everyone who reached out. And it's great to be back in our usual Friday spot here with STWPJ. And with all of these things going on, I do want to start in MLB this week. You have really with the first month gone, pretty much some of the teams that really have stood out. I mean, the Kansas City Royals continue to keep pace, 17-10 overall, and the Cleveland Guardians. And that's where I really wanted to start this show. You look at this Kansas City team, you know, from top to bottom, there's good youth there, but what are they getting that's helped them and allowed them to win 17 games in 27 tries this year? Salvi Perez is back. Plus 340 average, 7 dingers, 25 driven in thus far. You pair the command that he has behind the plate throughout his entire career in Kansas City. And then you talk about some of the youth that's there. You know, MJ Melendez is a young kid who's got some pop, hasn't hit for average. He's below the Mendoza line to this point in the season, but he's primarily been out in left field this year. He's a good young piece that they really like, as is Michael Garcia, who's commanded the hot corner and done a nice job. Between him and Bobby Witt, you've got two legitimate, and I guess if you put Darren Blanco out there, you've got three legitimate, but two if we focus on Garcia and Witt, base stealers. So if these guys are getting on base, now you want to see more from Michael Garcia, hitting 214. He's got the 4 home runs, 18 driven in. scored 12 runs. Witt's got 22 runs scored to this point. You want to see these guys consistently on base. And we've seen that with Bobby Witt. Now, if you can get a little more consistency from Michael Garcia, you know, I do think that as untouted as they were coming into the season, as unknown as many of the players were on this Kansas City team, I do think their staying power. Now, you get good veterans on this team, Hunter Renfro, Nelson Velasquez, Adam Frazier. You've got guys that can produce, especially when you're getting it at the top with Salvi Perez. And you've got a young first baseman who continues to develop in Vinny Pasquantino. I like what this Kansas City team is selling, and right now I'm buying it. As I am with the Cleveland Guardians, I went into the season, I was on that Minnesota Twins bandwagon, and I still am. I know they've got some injury problems. Royce Lewis, their really, really talented young shortstop, continues to battle injury really since having that, if we can call it that, that breakout campaign or half a campaign, if will you, from last year. You know, I still like this Twins team, but how can you not be enjoying what the Guardians are doing? 25 games in, 18-7, atop the Central. Now, you got perhaps the best team in the American League right now, the Guardians, and the worst team in baseball, both coming from the Central, because the White Sox are horrific. But if you're watching this Guardians team, I mean, from Josh Naylor has been really impressive. Average just dipped below 300, but he's been sitting there most of the season. He's smacking him over the wall, 20 driven in. He gets on base. And oh, by the way, you've got a perennial MVP contender in Jose Ramirez. Will Brennan out in right, Tyler Freeman in center giving you a good ball, and Estevan Florial's given a shot here in Cleveland. And I think with the sample size, while small in 15 games played and 40 at bats, hitting 250, he's hit a couple home runs and a few driven in, he's walking. But the problem with Florial is in 40 plate appearances, and this is something we saw developmentally in the minors when he was with the Yankees, in 40 plate appearances this season, he struck out 17 times. So that's problematic. But what they offer in this lineup between throwing a guy like Gabe Arias or Andrés Giménez, when you've got Naylor, Ramirez, Brennan, Freeman, Giménez I'll put in there, hitting 258. This is a legitimate Cleveland team that, much like the Royals, you know, I think that if you were putting money on it, you know, more people would have been open to the idea of Cleveland having a more successful campaign, at least out of the gate, than Kansas City. But to this point, you know, you like what you see from both of these teams. Staying into the top teams through this point in the season, you look at what the American League East looks like. And that is the division that always has eyes on it. From top to bottom, it's the deepest, it's the most talented, it's the one that offers the biggest threat to the rest of the league. Yankees and Orioles right now tied atop the AL East, Orioles 16-8, Yankees 17-9. Despite the fact that the Yankees sit at the top, and I'm a lifelong Yankee fan, I watch all the games, everybody that listens to the program knows that, is there really anything about this Yankee team? And they're good. This is a playoff team. I'm not saying they're not. But is there anything about this Yankee team that really jumps off the page at you and says, wow, this is an exciting team to watch? Didn't look good at all in a recent series against a bad Oakland team. And they've had their moments. And 17-9 is 17-9. Right now it's good enough in a tie for first in the American League East. But when you look at what the Yankees have now, we are still having these conversations in the Bronx about the fact that despite what they offer 1-9 in the lineup, even with the addition of Juan Soto, who's played extremely well as expected, that this Yankee offense sticks its head in the sand and disappears from time to time. Now, I suppose that is not a dire situation like it would be for some other teams who don't have as good of a bullpen. whose starting rotation has been brutal. That'd be a problem. Yankee rotation's been okay. Now you're thirsting to get Gerrit Cole back. Yeah, I think the small sample size thus far from Marcus Stroman overall, I know people like to disagree. I think he's been pretty good. Rodon, hit or miss. I'm not the biggest Nestor Cortez guy. Nothing against him. That doesn't do much for me. I like Luis Gil, who's on the mound tonight as the Yankees are out starting a series in Milwaukee against the Milwaukee team that's been pretty damn competitive to start the season. You know, I just think overall when you're comparing the Yankees and the Orioles, and speaking, by the way, this just happened a few hours ago. Orioles top prospect Jackson Holliday got sent back to the minors, which is interesting. I think he's in something of a 2-for-22 or 2-for-32 slump the last couple games. But developmentally, you know, I don't know how much better he's going to get by being sent back down to AAA, where he's already proven that he's just going to dominate these guys down there. So from my perspective, and, you know, Oriole fans and those in the know with the Orioles franchise, certainly more than I am, might have a different opinion or a different set of eyes on this. This is surprising, and I don't know that it's the best for his keyword development there, because you want to see him get those reps up at the big league. But look, the Orioles have proven with Brendan Hyde the last couple of years, they know what they're doing, building these things from the ground up and getting that staying power. It was just interesting to see that it's sort of out of nowhere. Yes, the kid has been slumping, but I don't know how much this is going to help. I guess it remains to be seen. You like to think the Orioles know what they're doing, his overall growth. But, you know, when you're comparing the Yankees and the Orioles right now, I think the Orioles have a little more flair, a little more pizzazz. They're certainly younger in the key spots. But, you know, for the time being, Yanks going out to Milwaukee, they are tied for first right now in the always competitive American League East. With that being said, first caller on the line is Mike. Mike,
yeah, hi, Pete. How you doing?
What's going on?
I know, talking about the Yankees, the hitting's been disappointing other than Soto. But in my opinion, I think as good as Soto is, the Yankees won't roll until Judge hits. I think he's the big engine that gets the moving. Not that Soto was not good, but
Judge and Torres have been black holes in this lineup.
Yeah, absolutely. This is as bad as a slump as I've seen Judge have. I mean, fastball's right down the middle. He's missing.
Yeah, there had been, writers that follow these teams and whatnot. The fear was that. Yeah, you mentioned the fastballs. The concern had been the breaking balls, like it was in his rookie year, where right. He just seems very off balance. And that's scary because I don't think there's any indication that they would flip him and Soto in that lineup. I mean, again, Aaron Judge is not hitting. Gleyber Torres is not hitting. You don't have Gerrit Cole, and you've got some other injuries. DJ LeMahieu, concern exists there, and you're still 17-9. So, you know, and you're still tied at least for the moment for first place in the division, granted with 140 games left to go. But this is, you know, I'm not being dismissive of this because, yes, Aaron Judge not hitting. And oh, by the way, with that monster contract, yes, that is a reason to be concerned and you should be concerned.
Yeah.
And just as piggybacking what you said, as far as Soto goes, I mean, this could be one of those things, at least early on, because he is so adept at getting on base and not swinging at garbage, which makes him so lethal, even at still the young age of 25. Yeah. This might be in the early part of this season, the Yankees go as Juan Soto goes.
That's true. You're right. One other quick comment before I go.
Sure.
Watching the draft, being a huge Giant fan that I am, I was really disappointed they didn't take McCarthy, who was laying there right for them. But I guess the Giants didn't like him. I don't know.
Well, from J.J. McCarthy's perspective, he was saying during the week that the team he met the most with was the New York Giants.
Yeah, I thought he was their pick.
I think the consensus was, and I was watching it on, I know ESPN and NFL Network were anchoring it last night. I was watching ESPN because I'm a big Adam Schefter guy, and he was talking about the fact that it was quarterback and playmaker. And what it came down to was the fact that you like it or lump it, you've got your quarterback this year, assuming Daniel Jones is ready to roll week one with that contract, which the Giants, of course, can get out of after this season, even though it was a four-year deal. You're going to throw a rookie wide receiver to the Wolves, potentially, with no one to throw the football to. And the Giants need playmakers, and they've got a kid that they like in Jalin Hyatt. Now they can pair him with a kid like Malik Nabers, who many thought, even in a draft that included Romo Dunze and Marvin Harrison Jr., that Malik Nabers was the best wide receiver in the draft. They got him. And I didn't necessarily have an issue with that, though I know there is a wide base of Giant fans that were screaming for the quarterback.
Right. Well, I was one of them.
Well, we'll see what they do tonight. The second round of the draft's underway in a little bit. Giants and amongst many teams that could use some help in the secondary defensively. Maybe they grab a quarterback. Maybe it's a Spencer Rattler, Travis coming off that terrible injury from Florida State. There's guys there.
Yeah, they I saw Rattler play. He's not bad.
No, I mean, he had a good career at Oklahoma when he transferred, and he played. I think he was a little underwhelming at South Carolina, but he's got a big arm. So we'll see what transpires as rounds two and three are tonight. But Mike, as always, thank you for the call, brother.
Okay. We'll talk to you. Good luck, Pete.
So yeah, and we're gonna get on the draft stuff momentarily. But yeah, there's a lot of good points there. There's a lot of things that you can pick apart, and we'll do that in a couple minutes. I just want to wrap up when we're talking about the beginning portion of this Major League Baseball season. You know, I think, as underwhelming from an excitability standpoint and the fear that the Yankees offense disappears at times, you know, I think a lot has to do with sort of what our caller Mike just said, that Judge has been a zero in the lineup. Gleyber Torres has been a zero in the lineup. It's nice to see Anthony Volpe's, by the way, another young, phenomenal, developing player in this Yankee team. And this kid is just so fun to watch. Anthony Rizzo starting to swing a better bat as well. By the way, the second round of the draft is underway. Bills started off the second round with the first pick of round two. Florida State's Keon Coleman, the wide receiver. So that's a nice pick for Buffalo to start. They have to replace Stephon Diggs, obviously. So they get off a nice foot after not having a pick in the opening round. You're looking at how well, you know, this American League West, right? Those who follow the program know we spent the last 3 weeks of the regular season a year ago talking about how exciting the AL West race was coming down to, with the Rangers, who obviously would go on to win the World Series. The Astros would get in the tournament. It was the Mariners, the odd men looking out. Well, now this AL West has been pretty disappointing to start the season, but you've got a hot Seattle team, 7-3 in the last 10. So they have a slight lead atop that division. You know, and I think probably the most disappointing team in all of baseball have been the Houston Astros at 7-19. I mean, Jose Abreu has simply disappeared at first base, and it's been tough to watch. You know, collectively, obviously, there's individualism involved in baseball, but it is a team sport, and it has been tough to watch this Astros team, who's 3-10 on the road. They're 2-8 over their last 10 games, only 4-9 at home. I mean, you just... In my over-unders, I did have them going under their number, but not because I thought they were a bad team. This is an alarming start for a team that has been a perennial pennant-chasing team for the better part of the last 5 to 7 years. So it's been a little tough to watch this Houston team. You talk about Atlanta. I mean, now it looks like they're really starting to roll, right? They've won 9 of 10, 17-6 overall, 2.5 games clear of Philly, who has won 8 of 10 in their own right. The Cubs in the Central, 16-9, they've won 7 of 10. And the Mets are hanging tough in that National League East. They don't do a lot to wow you either, but 7-3 across their last 10, 4.5 games, they're within Atlanta. Yeah, and you talk about the who's hot versus the who's not. Pittsburgh, good start. They've dropped 8 of 10. The White Sox, as I mentioned before, absolutely brutal. No pitching, minimal offense, 3 of 22 overall, and they are 1-9 in their last 10. The Rockies and Marlins are a combined 13-39 as well, as they sit at the bottom of their respective divisions. And you just look across the standings. You got the Yanks and the O's and the AL East tied. The Guardians are too clear of the Royals in the American League Central. You know, I do like this Seattle team. I ultimately think it'll be a battle between them and Texas, I don't expect Houston to sit in the cellar all season, but I do like the Mariners and the Rangers. There are obviously plenty of baseball left to go. This is Atlanta's division. Philly's a playoff team, but this is Atlanta's division. And then I think the National League Central will be the fun one. You go out west, you look at the Dodgers, 16-11. Yeah, interesting sort of start there with all the money they were throwing around in the offseason. Padres right behind them. The D-backs, last year's NL winners, are there as well. And the Giants are 12-14. But you look at the NL Central. Right now, the Brewers and the Cubs virtually tied for first place, but the Reds are competitive. You don't sleep on the Cardinals. And this Pirates team, especially in the pitching department, starting to develop these young guys, the future is bright there. And you know, I think we're off to a good start here with this MLB season. I do believe that, and I think it's going to continue to develop as we start to get our footing going into May, June, and deeper on into the summer.
With you every week.
Sports Today with Peter J.
Yeah, we are here every week or most weeks, right? I thank you again for those who reached out on Instagram. Of course, it's at Sports Today with Peter J, J-A-Y. Wondering where the show was, had to take a couple-week hiatus. Daddy duty, school duty, a little traveling for Notre Dame stuff. Speaking of which, promoting my other podcast through the Irish Tribune, one of the affiliates in Notre Dame Athletics, fully credentialed member of the Notre Dame media. The podcast is First and Gold, and you can find it on all major platforms. It's a weekly Notre Dame-centric show focused on Notre Dame football, recruiting news, and other sports on campus. The Irish Tribune, www.theirishtribune.com, covering all things Fighting Irish sports, including feature pieces, game recaps, and interviews. It's the Irish Tribune for your weekly show, First and Gold, with myself, Peter J. Mulroy, and my broadcast partner, Nick Kramer. And we are your number one source for up-to-the-minute news on the Fighting Irish. It's www.theirishtribune.com, at the Irish Tribune on social, and at First and Gold Pod, P-O-D, across social platforms as well. So round one of the NFL draft begins last night. Ladd McConkey, by the way, just going to the Chargers. So Jim Harbaugh gets another receiver to pair with Justin Herbert after drafting Joe Alt, number five, the tackle out of Notre Dame, with his first pick since taking the reins in L.A. after winning a national championship at Michigan. You know, you watched the beginning of the draft last night, and it was becoming sort of a running joke that not too often do these drafts actually go chalk. And I think overall, you know, from my perspective, you knew Caleb Williams was going one to Chicago. And I think you had a pretty good sense that Jaden Daniels would follow him and go to D.C. with the second pick overall. That's what happened. Now, you're thinking about what the Pats might do. Is it a J.J. McCarthy? Is it a Drake May? Ultimately, it was Drake May. So you get quarterback, 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 one, two, three, boom, boom, boom. Not a surprise. Marvin Harrison out of Ohio State, the wideout going to Arizona, also not a surprise. And Joe Alt, the left tackle out of Notre Dame. And it looks like he'll flip to the right side, which makes sense in L.A., going to the Chargers with the fifth pick. So I think right down the line, one through five, all made sense, no shocks. Malik Nabers to the Giants at six, another notable pick. Look, Mike called and was asking about why not J.J. McCarthy. I get it. And you had your opportunity there if you wanted your quarterback. But the Giants also need playmakers. And don't forget, you don't have Saquon Barkley there anymore, which, believe me, I don't think it's going to be a total disaster like people think. It's terrible if you're a Giants fan that he went to Philly. But you need playmakers now. And you got to get guys that stretch the field. You've got one that you continue to develop in Jalen Hyatt. Now you have another one here with Malik Nabers. And people love to rail on Daniel Jones. And I get it. I'm not a defender of Daniel Jones. I'm not a critic, right? If you want to play the political spectrum, I'm a moderate Daniel Jones guy, okay? But it is, just think about this rationally and logically. If you can't keep your quarterback upright, and he doesn't have weaponry out of Saquon Barkley coming out of the backfield, what the hell do you want the kid to do? And I think that was the mindset last night. You have to love the quarterback you're going to draft, because that's the one position that you better damn well get right when you have a high pick. it would be a it. I mean, Carolina might be going through it now with everything they got last year, gave up to get Bryce Young and flip all these picks back to Chicago that they basically parlayed into Caleb Williams. And now the opportunity, which they did last night, to get Romo Odunze at number 9. So you get a quarterback wide receiver duo. I mean, that could be the fleece of the century if Bryce Young doesn't pan out. But much, and DJ Moore going to Chicago in that deal, oh, by the way. But from the perspective of guys like Young and Daniel Jones, if you have no one to throw the ball to, and you don't have time to scratch your ass back there, you're going down. Giants lost 2 quarterbacks last year in the Miami game alone. So, yes, they have to rebuild their offensive line. They did that in the offseason. In my opinion, the better way to build the offensive line, yes, you could do it during the draft. The Dallas Cowboys showed us a path to doing that. But you can do it with sensical signings and free agency. And then you go get your playmakers in the draft. Giants did that last night. It is nice to have a GM and ownership group. Well, I'll just say a general manager, because you know how I feel about the Giants ownership group right now. All they did just perpetually piss me off. But it is nice to have a GM and a head coach who actually communicate and make sensible moves and logical moves. And it will be very interesting to see what the Giants do tonight. Because you could be looking at maybe a Cooper DeJean to bolster that secondary. You know, the Giants picked 47th overall. It'll be the 15th pick tonight. They got 2 wide receivers that just went off the board. For those listening live in round 2, Keon Coleman, Florida State, goes to the Bills. Ladd McConkey, who's got speed and a half out of Georgia, and he's a big-time playmaker when you need it most, goes to the Chargers. Falcons on the clock now. These are all jockey trades, jockeying positioning through making deals during and prior to the draft. So we're underway in round 2, 3 picks off the board. You talk about last night, I think, obviously, and I'm not reinventing the wheel here, the first shocker, if you will, came at pick 8. The Falcons go Michael Penix Jr., the left-handed signal caller out of Washington, who took him to the national title game last year. It's interesting, yes, because Atlanta signed Kirk Cousins to the free agent deal in the offseason. Cousins coming off an Achilles injury, you want to have that legit backup. All right, Desmond Ridder out of town now with Cousins coming on board, so they bring in Penix. The problem for many people is that Michael Penix, during his time at Indiana, prior to transferring to Washington, had 4 seasons at Indiana, all 4 of them ending with season-ending injuries. That's eye-opening. That can't be dismissed. Now, he goes out to Washington and has a hell of a career out there. So the injury concerns exist. If you're listening to Penix like I was earlier in the week and last week even, he's not worried about his injury. Of course, he's going to say that. But look, this is a team that I'm sure Atlanta fans, you need the defensive help. You could have gone with a Dallas Turner, Jared Verse, the really versatile defensive end from Florida State, Byron Murphy, the tackle from Texas, to bolster that defensive front. I'm personally okay with the Penix selection here, because now he's definitely part of the future, right? He's in the future cards. Kirk Cousins coming off the Achilles injury, not getting any younger, still has the big arm. But I think overall, the health holds up for Penix. When Falcon fans sit down, breathe, right, chill out for a second, you see the arm strength, you see the vision, intelligence, and overall athleticism. You've got a player here, perhaps early, but if it works out, who cares? And the other big selections from last night, I mentioned Neighbors going to the Giants. J.J. McCarthy goes 10th to Minnesota. So there's your replacement for Cousins. Bo Nix goes 12th to Denver. I thought that was a bit of a reach. We'll see how this works out. Romo Odunze goes to Chicago 9th as they pair him with Williams. And then the Jets grab Olu Fashanu, the really good tackle, out of Penn State, 11th. So I don't know that there was too much chaos and jockeying last night. You know, I thought it was a good story that Liatu Latu from UCLA, the edge rusher, goes to the Colts at pick 15. He was told multiple times to end his football career due to injury. He was medically told to stop playing football. All he does is come out and become the first edge rusher drafted in the draft yesterday, and he's got a clean bill of health. And this, you know, I know a lot of teams would have crossed a guy like Latu off their boards, but when you watch the film, and if you're a late-night junkie for college football like I am, there's plenty of UCLA games that you were able to see. Kid's good. And he knows what he's doing, too. So good on the Colts going up and get a premier edge rusher in this draft. Minnesota grabbing Dallas Turner after getting J.J. McCarthy, I thought was genius. You're filling two holes that you desperately need there on a Minnesota defense that I thought even overachieved last year in some spots, as bad as they were expected to be. Now you're working with something here, assuming the development. We'll see where McCarthy goes in this process. Year one and beyond. Xavier Worthy, the wideout from Texas, going 28th to Kansas City. I mean, how much more speed do the Kansas City Chiefs need? I think it was very fitting. Nate Wiggins, the corner from Clemson, going to Baltimore, made a ton of sense. And I loved what Carolina did at 32. Xavier Leggett, the really good wide receiver from South Carolina. You talk about teams that need playmakers, and every team needs them. I mean, Carolina's got nothing. And they absolutely need that help right now in the playmaker department if Bryce Young is going to survive at all moving forward. So we're keeping an eye on what we have tonight. Rounds two and three. Round two is already underway. The Commander sitting on the clock for those listening live. They'll pick twice in this second round, and the New York Giants will pick 15th tonight. In this second round, Giants could go many different avenues. You need that offensive line help, even though they did a nice job in the offseason, but you've got to get some playmakers, and you really want to support yourself in that secondary. I think Cooper DeJean, if he's there, which I doubt, the really good defensive back from Iowa would make a ton of sense. But look, there's a lot of talent here. This is where you build your team, all right? Round one is the flair. You get the star player, you hope. And then, you know, two, three, four, and five, this is where you start to build your franchise. And this is where the real know-it-all communication, common sense element of drafting and building a team comes into play. So we'll definitely be keeping an eye on that as we transition from the NFL draft talk to the NBA and NHL playoffs. But there's plenty going on now to have the football world excited once again.
Subscribe and don't miss the next episode.
Sports Today with Peter J.
Yeah, you can subscribe across all platforms: Google, iHeart, TuneIn, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, the works, and of course, right here on Podbean. And again, those of you who reached out to me on Instagram, I appreciate it. The messaging about when the show is going to return, and those of you who parlayed that into now following us at the Irish Tribune with the First in Gold pod. Really spectacular stuff. I appreciate it. And I'll definitely try to be a little more consistent, but it's nice to know that there's a legitimate following out there when the inbox is stacking up with, when's the show back on? Can I call in? Can I ask questions? Yes, you can mailbag it all the time. Best place to do that, Instagram at Sports Today with Peter J, J-A-Y. All right. NBA playoffs obviously underway, and it's been fun for the most part. But what I will say is this Celtics Heat series, you don't ever sleep on an Eric Spoelstra team. And if you watch game two, how good Miami was with seven guys, at least one three-pointer made in that game two in Boston to even the series at one. You know, this is one of those series. I like Boston as the best team in the NBA, the top seed in the East, to come out with this thing. But it's going to be interesting now going back as the series shifts to South Beach in a 1-1 tilt where you know what Miami was able to do and get to the finals last year as the eight. And taking down some pretty damn good teams, including the Knicks, on their way. So this is going to be an interesting series to continue to watch, as is this Bucks-Pacer game. Now, I came on the air with Indiana up 12 at the break going into the fourth quarter for those tuned in live. Indiana's up 7 going into the fourth, 90-83. This is another series where, Damian Lillard got banged up earlier in game three tonight. Where is the support going to come with no Giannis? And I think as he has the left solar strain, I think this is a problem for Milwaukee. Obviously it is. Now, Bobby Portis is a nice player. Middleton's a nice player. Brooke Lopez is at a renaissance, and Pat Bev's good. But outside, you know, with Lillard, he's the alpha there. It's going to have to be Lillard and Middleton If Milwaukee's going to get this done, because this Indiana team with Halliburton, Nembhard, Turner, Nesmith, and Siakam, and then you add in the depth, Obi Toppin's got 15 and 6 already tonight. This is a team that is can create nightmare matchups for any team they're going to play. So you've got that series tied at 1, Indiana with a 7-point lead going into the fourth, Boston, Miami tied at 1, Cleveland's got a 2-1 edge over Orlando. A lot of good, a lot of bad in that series, right through the first three games. And then Cleveland, the 4 seed, Orlando, the 5, as they'll play the next few games in Orlando. And then you got Knicks Sixers. And the Knicks really were very lucky to come out of game 2 with a victory. Down 5, 30 seconds left. Dante DiVincenzo off a couple of offensive rebounds, able to hit the game-winning 3. But the Knicks were very much in danger of going back to Philly tied 1-1. Instead, they go to Philly up 2-0. But last night it was Joel Embiid's 40-plus performance that really sealed the victory for Philly, as it'll be 2-1 Knicks going into game 4. But I'll say this, and everybody knows where I'm going. A couple of moments last night with Joel Embiid, with the flagrants that he picked up. Anyone else lowers the elbow into the danger zone on a man, and you know exactly what I'm talking about, and then trips someone in the paint while on the floor. Anyone else does that, then a superstar in the NBA, they're out of the game. Perhaps suspended for the next one. I mean, I thought it was despicable that it happened twice with Embiid, and that wasn't an outcome. Anyone else is gone. Not named LeBron James, probably. To sit there, stick your foot out, and try to trip the opposition, and act as and play dumb as if you didn't do anything. Now, Philly was going to win the game. They were in control, if you watch the game, for the most part. Knicks had it, you know, early on, and then Philly just started laying the hammer to them. Philly's making threes, and Knicks coming back with twos. Not a recipe for success, but the Knicks still have the series lead. But I thought the actions of Embiid and then the corresponding response were both despicable. And that's not just coming from the perspective of a lifelong Knicks fan. It is what it is. You know, we've seen dirtbag moves from guys like Draymond Green in the past, and he got the heave-ho. I mean, Green's made a freaking career out of that. And Embiid had a nice night last night, too. You give your side the victory, 125-114. And that is what a lot of people are going to remember from that game. Now, I'm sure the Philly faithful probably have no problem with it. But the guy goes for 50 points last night. Hits 71% of his threes, 5 of 7. 8 rebounds. A block. 5 assists. And we're talking about his dirtbag actions on the floor. It's a problem. And we'll see what the Knicks' response is coming out in game 4. Because it's easier said than done with a league MVP. But you got to find a way to stop this guy. You better find a way to slow him down. And you got a Mitchell Robinson out there who I like, who's not 100% healthy. Despite what anyone might say. This is a big game in the series for the Knicks, and obviously Philly. I'm not Nostradamus saying that. But the way the Knicks fell apart in game 3, after being heroic in games 1 and 2, you got to find a way to come out and win game 4 on the road. Take back total control. Right now you've got control. You've got the ever-important 2-1 lead. Same thing with Cleveland over Orlando. You've got to find a way, New York, to win that fourth game. And they can do it. They've got the depth to do it. Just get it done. Out west, you got OKC, who's a damn good team. 2-0 over the Pelicans. That could be a quick ending to this thing. Clips Mavs is a good series, tied at 1. You know, I liked Dallas in this series coming in. I'm going to stay there. And Phoenix is in trouble out west with Minnesota. Now, Minnesota's good, but this is going to be changes galore coming for this 6-seeded Suns team. If they go into a 3-0 hole and lose this thing in 4 or 5, heads are going to roll. And that's the direction that they're trending right now in this 2-0 hole against a very good Minnesota team. And look, Denver's on another path, up 3-0 against a Lakers team that just can't get out of its own way right now. So they're a game away, are the defending champs, from moving on, where they would get the winner of the Timberwolves Suns series. So it's going to be interesting. It's going to be fun. Look, I liked Denver. I liked Minnesota. I liked the Mavericks as a slight underdog over the Clippers and obviously the Thunder. I'm heavy on the Celtics, even though the series is tied at one. I liked Orlando over Cleveland there in a 2-1 hole. I was big on Indiana, especially with the banged up Giannis over the Bucks, and obviously I like the Knicks here over Philly, though it has the potential to be somewhat dicey if Philly's able to even this damn thing at two games apiece after game four. So it's going to be thrilling the rest of the way. I mean, I think the Knicks-Philly series is must-watch, and I would say, you know, despite the one blowout the other night, that the Cleveland-Orlando series is certainly going to be something fun to watch, as is the LA Dallas series. And you've got all of this going on while you have the NHL playoffs going on. So it is certainly going to be worthwhile keeping an eye on all of that action.
Make sure to leave a review. This makes our day and fuels future episodes.
Sports Today with Peter J.
And you can leave many of those reviews. They come to me personally, and you can do it right through Instagram, of course, at Sports Today with Peter J. That's J-A-Y, at Sports Today with Peter J. J-A-Y. You got the NHL playoffs going on simultaneously with the NBA. And I think the one thing to this point that has stood out, two things. Vegas is good despite the second wild card seeding because the West was so loaded all year. But to have a 2-0 lead over a really good Dallas team is something that stands out to me. And by the way, that second thing, the Florida Panthers might be the best team in this entire tournament. They are completely dismantling a Tampa Bay team that came in as hot as anyone on the planet entering the playoffs. So they've got a 3-0 lead there. Dallas is in a 2-0 hole against the defending champion Knights. I went out on the limb. I fell in love with the Vegas team last year. I picked them in this series. I did not think that they would jump on them this quickly. I liked Florida over Tampa. And then I go to this Boston-Toronto series where I picked Toronto. They're in a 2-1 hole. You know, I think this series is living up to the hype. This has been fun hockey to watch with the Bruins and the Maple Leafs here through these first three games. And you watch the makeup of how this continues to develop. Game four Saturday, for those listening live, the 27th, 8 p.m. Eastern. That's a TBS, I think it's a TBS game. Let me get back to you on that. I believe it's a TBS game, but it's definitely Saturday, 8 p.m. You're looking at Boston, really, if it's able to get the game four victory, you've got control of the series, but there's so much, and it is a TBS game. There's so much firepower on both sides here. That anything can happen, especially with so many good two-way players. I mean, how good is Austin Matthews, obviously, and then the depth that Boston and the veteran leadership that they've been able to continue to play at a high level with has just been really, really fun to watch. You look at what the Rangers are doing. No real surprises there. Got a little dicey in game two the other night, but this is a Washington team that is not quintessential capital, even with Ovi. It's a Washington team that really struggles to score at crucial moments. They've been battling that for most of the season. Rangers up 2-0. You got game three going on right now. First period, Rangers have a 2-1 lead as the series is back in D.C. Game four will be Sunday in D.C. On TBS, 8 p.m. puck drop for game four Sunday on the East Coast. But again, game three underway in the first period. Rangers have a 2-1 lead on the road and a 2-0 series lead. Carolina's got the Islanders on the brink, up 3-0. Edmonton-LA is a fun series. Tied at one, two games in. High-scoring affairs both ways. Edmonton gets the game one win. LA comes back in overtime, wins game two. You got game three tonight, 10:30 Eastern start, TBS. This is another series where this entire bracket, you know, I mentioned in the NBA, it's you, in my opinion, you've got the LA Dallas series, you've got the Knicks Philly, and then in my opinion, Cleveland Orlando. Those are the series that I would be must watch, right? Especially Knicks Philly, just for the I-95 rivalry and the fact that the fan bases hate each other with a passion. In the NHL, I would say right now, with the exception of this Carolina series, this is must see hockey every single night, including this Ranger Capital series. Because if you've been watching hockey, the Rangers have been the best team in the league all year. And they've got a legitimate shot at this thing. And I love this matchup with Colorado Winnipeg. And if you saw game one, you know what I'm talking about. 7-6 Winnipeg gets the job done in game one. And then Colorado fires right back. Short-term memory, 5-2 victory game two. Game three tonight. There's a lot of good hockey on, folks, the next couple of nights. This is a great time, not just to be a hockey fan, but a sports fan. I mean, these series are great. I actually liked Winnipeg in this series as the slight favorite, and I'll stay with the Jets there. Vancouver, Nashville is 1-1. Yeah, I thought about toying with my pick and going with Nashville, but I stuck it with Vancouver. Carolina, for me, I thought the Islanders would be a little more physical. They might get a game here, but Carolina's going to put this thing away. And obviously, I was all over the Rangers, as the Capitals just struggled to score. But obviously, keep you abreast here as the tournaments continue in the NBA and the NHL playoffs. And I thought the NFL got off to a great start with the first round of the draft last night. Just to update you, Tavondre Sweat, really good D tackle from Texas, is off the board. He goes to Tennessee with pick number 38 overall. So you had Keon Coleman, the first pick in the second round tonight, go to Buffalo. Ladd McConkey. So the first two players tonight, Florida State, Georgia, two wide receivers. Coleman to Buffalo, McConkey to the Chargers. Ruke Orihoro, the defensive tackle from Clemson, goes to Atlanta. Zahan Newton, a defensive tackle from Illinois, goes to the Commanders. Jalen Polk, an underrated wide receiver from Florida, goes to the Patriots. And then, as I just said, Tavondre Sweat, a really athletic defensive tackle, pick number 38 to Tennessee. The LA Rams are now on the clock. So rounds two and three tonight, NFL draft, plenty of NBA, plenty of NHL. We'll keep you up to date each and every week right here. Even on social media, if I can't do the show, I will do a much better job at promoting that. That is my bad. But obviously, you can continue to follow everything we're doing here at Sports Today with Peter J, at Sports Today with Peter J, J-A-Y, on Instagram. And obviously, you can check out everything we're doing over at the Irish Tribune, a fully credentialed member of the Notre Dame Sports Media. IrishTribune.com, and you can follow us at First and Gold Pod and at the Irish Tribune across all social platforms. It was a fun one, folks. Enjoy the rest of the weekend. Plenty going on. I'll see you next week, Friday, May 3rd, 7 p.m. Eastern Time, right here. Subscribe across the board, Google, iHeart, Apple, Spotify, tune in, and right here on Podbean. Have a great week, everybody. And as always, go Irish.
Listen to Sports Today with Peter J every Friday at 7 p.m. Eastern on Podbean, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and iHeartRadio. We'll see you there.